rolling. We're rolling.
No, we're live.
We're live, man. All right. Welcome back to the show, everybody. Those of you who are tuning into the Planting Seeds podcast, we've finally arrived. We finally arrived, brother. You don't need no introduction, brother, but just jump in here. Who are you and what are the things that interest you and what do you do, bro?
My name is Israel Adesanya, and most people might know me now as the middleweight champion of the world in the UFC. Again, middleweight champion of the world in the UFC.
Let's go.
Yeah, I think for me, I'm quite an eclectic person, so that's why I'm hoping like I want to see where this goes, because sometimes whenever I've done these kind of things, it's more based around fighting.
Yeah,
it's always based around fighting and like, you know, it's epic. It's always based around fighting and, you know, this and that. How you gonna beat this guy? But we can touch in a little bit on that. But interests like me. I'm sure you know I used to dance, you know, still do, but I don't battle anymore. And as a 30-year-old now, I just turned 30, so I'm still curious. I'm still trying to figure out this whole thing we call life. Like, as we were talking before, like, I look like I've got to figure it out, but I'm like, what the fuck am I doing?
Instagram makes it look that way,
exactly.
Eh, bro?
Oh, bro, I know how to farm the Instagram. Yeah. I did it for years, but, yeah, so it's just, for me, just... I'm curious. I'm just always questioning things in life, anything, even my beliefs. I'm like questioning, like, why do I believe that? You know, what programmed me, or what, you know, helped, what got me to this point? So, yeah.
But I think that's just mean, just curious and like challenging your way of thinking. I think what that does, it allows you to broaden your mindset as well as your state of being. Whereas 100%. If you're just closed off to your belief, I think that just limits you to the experience of what you can experience.
Facts.
And I think before we even start into this, bro, I think we should talk about how we connected, and it comes, you know, for a mutual friend of ours, you know, the brother Ra.
Howdy, Nelson.
The big raw cookie.
Shout out to Ra.
Shout out to that fella, man. Yeah. And I think once, you know, just talking about the bro, once you connect and you're his mate, like, he remembers, like, you know, he definitely holds you
close. I was
actually
surprised we were friends, because in high school, like, you know, I went to Rokura, shout out to Rokura Boys High School. Like, he was the cool kid, you know, he was big, baller, like, fucking just had it all sussed. And I didn't know how to ball, even though I was black. And I used to just, like, watch this kid just, like, own everyone on the court. And then somehow, when Rice came out, then I started crumping. And then he kind of like, just like, started being my friend. And I was like, oh, I can teach you how to dance. And then he learned how to, I remember the first round he ever threw at me. And I was like, whoa, this guy's been practicing. And yeah, just like, he's such a dude that, another guy that you think you know him, but then there's a lot, like, there's a lot of levels. There's a lot of deep stuff, you know, with him. And I just like his playfulness, man. That's one thing I think that we connect.
And that low voice, eh, bro?
Oh, yeah, hey, bro. Oh, my bro, my bro.
You know,
oh,
but like,
such a giant.
He's one of those fellas, bro, that will always check in, eh?
Yeah,
you know,
definitely,
it could
definitely
be like years, but he'll always just check in how you up. Like, no, it'll just no matter be random. What, like, even how
if,
you been?
Yeah. We're going to catch up now, I think, for the first time in like 2.5 years. UFC 243, because he's going to come to the fight. But it's just going to be like we pick up where we left off, you know what I mean? And even through not talking and stuff, we've had our ups and downs, but at the end of the day, we always circle back to love,
right?
Circle back to like the truth, which
brotherhood.
Is like, exactly, the brotherhood. Like, I fight with my brothers, I fought with my parents, with family, you know, shit like that. But at the end of the day, always circle back to the truth, you know, that love, that connection. That's cool.
It. And I think when you can go to those raw spaces, like with friends, with family, and you can still sort of appreciate that love is the highest, you know, 100%. That's when you know it's real.
Definitely.
Whereas if you have like a sort of a miscomms or a disagreement and that's it.
That cut you off.
You know, like, was that a real friendship or not? You know, and I think just being able to sustain it through that, I think, fuck, amazing things come from it. So just really wanted to do a big shout out to the bro, Rob, because
we met through him, but I'm still trying to think, was it in Adelaide?
It was in Adelaide.
Bro, that fight, that was the fight. Okay, that was that weekend. Yeah,
that was the first time I heard about you. Yeah. You know, we met, you won. And I remember, bro, I was like, sweet, we're going to go out.
Yeah.
And you're sort of staying in like the flash part. of Adelaide, and we just met up in town.
Glenelg. Every time they always put us there. That's one thing I liked about Ethan Shep. They always put us in the hotel over there, and it was nice beachfront, and I always felt like, this is what it's going to be like.
Yeah, exactly.
Good time. Yeah.
And then we met up in town, and then I remember when you first got there. With Troj. It was me and the bro, Troj. Yeah. And remember, I had a little scuffle that night prior to you coming.
I missed it. We came just after.
Yeah, that's right.
He still seemed smiley, and I was like, oh, you had a fight?
Yeah. No, we didn't. I don't know what the hell happened. Yeah. I think, you know.
Well, you seemed like you brushed it off. Like, you were just like, ah.
Yeah. Like, I think I was just so, like, happy that, you know, we're just going to have this night. And I remember you rocked up with this leather jacket zipped up. Yeah. I was like, what's this kid up to? You know, we walk in. You know, everyone sort of knew that you were coming in. As soon as we get in, just zip. Just flips the back like Michael Jackson, and this man just got his belt on.
What an asshole.
Flex.
I remember that as well.
It was just this.
Because for me, it's a little bit, I have to feel the vibe, and that was my attitude still till this day. Like back then, if I want a belt, I want to just flex with it. It's what not every fighter does, but certain fighters who just feel themselves they can. And I kind of went in just like, I just want to see, you know, you don't want to be a...
Bro, you look like Morpheus, bro.
Yeah. Coming in like a... So I was just like, let me see what the vibe is. And eventually, I think that was the first time I realized that Aussie girls were different. Because normally for me, especially back then when I was coming up, it was like... you know, no one gives you the time of day. Oh, who's this fucking bitch ass? Da, da, da. But then, like, I remember, like, they were just so friendly, and they didn't even know who I was. And that kind of, like, let me, like, all right, okay, I'm feeling cool.
Behold. I remember we were just, like, went all nuts. But, you know, you're just such a good man about it. Like, people were wanting to hold it. You'll put it on them.
I almost lost it. I remember it was either you or Troj grabbed it. Because at some point, some guy was just wearing it. And that was, I was young. But we've all been there. We were young. But, and I lost my memories that night. Let's put it that way. Yeah, a lot. Yeah. I missed my flight as well.
Bro, because honestly, I remember we're just having such the meanest night. I was like, bro, who cares, bro? Like, don't worry. Like, I'll shut your flight.
Yeah,
in.
He got me a flight back as
you
well.
Know? And honestly, bro, I just didn't even have the money. I remember the next day, like, you turned up at the house. I was like, sweet, man, we got this fellow. You ended up staying again.
You and Troj looked after me, man. I really appreciated that. And we went out for food.
And then I remember I was texting the bro. I was like, fuck, bro, can you spot me some money? I need to get this fellow flight back home.
Oh, you mean right?
So ended up, one of my workmates, Nelson, hit him up.
I didn't even know about that. Yeah. That's the thing. I appreciate that, brother.
So I ended up getting you back, but I think that just what started the connection. And for me, it was just like, man, if we can just have so much fun and just, you know, just vibe on that.
Even the next day, we had pizza the next day. I remember. Yeah, and Emmanuel was there as well. Emmanuel was hanging out. Bro. Yeah. And
chocolate dropper.
Yeah, chocolate dropper. You know, he's engaged now.
Yeah, he is.
Oh, man, yeah. He's chilling down. He's settling down now. That's cool.
Yeah. And then I remember, you know, we just went into some deep conversations, you know, the very next day, you know, just around the mindset. And I remember there was a time when I started working in the mines while I was over there. And I used to always just keep tabs on you. And you said this one quote that always, I don't know if it was from you or if you said it from somewhere, but you said, whoever said the sky was the limit didn't know about the universe.
Oh, yo.
And I was just like,
that's all me.
Yo, and I was just thinking, I was like,
I've heard that so many times. Sky's the limit, bro. Sky's the limit. And I'm like, has anyone been past the sky? Do you know there's a whole universe out there? So whenever people talk about like sky's the limit, and it's just like another one of those things that's passed down, like another quote that people just parrot and don't even like think about it. I'm like, why is the sky the limit? It's not actually the limit. Like, we know there's space.
Yeah.
So why are we saying the sky's the limit? It's not the fucking limit. Like, there's more. Yeah. So I've kind of used that in different aspects of life, in a lot of aspects of life. Like, we were just talking about my last fight as well, that fifth round, when I thought, oh, I've hit the limit now, last level. It's like, oh, no, wait. There's more.
There's more.
There's always more in everything, man, in everything in life. Yeah.
Just that breakthrough, though, eh? And just that willingness to allow yourself to think. You know, just that freedom of thought.
And a lot of people can't, though. They're chained down by what they think. And this is not like no disrespect to anyone or any culture or any religion or something, but like a lot of ideologies sometimes, they help people in a lot of ways. But sometimes I've seen it as well, even in my country, like when I went back to Nigeria, I saw like a lot of ideologies, old ideologies that like tie people down and never let them progress. And it's just like sheeple, because people want to belong. Yeah. I still want to belong. Everyone wants to belong to some kind of tribe, so they agree to, like, you know,
to it's conform.
Kind of,
eh?
It's like that. What was that story? The king in the robe, and everyone was like, "Oh, that's a nice robe," but the king's naked. Until one kid is like, "Nah, you're naked. Like, what are you doing?"
Yeah.
Have you heard that story?
No, I haven't heard that one.
I can't how it goes, but like, as a king, he wanted like the finest silk or whatever, da, 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 and then this con man made him like this robe, and he didn't make anything. He just fucking just like said, "This is a robe. Put it on him. Like, pretend like it's putting something on him." Yeah. And the king's like, "Yes, actually, this looks really nice," because he didn't want to seem like an idiot. Like, "Oh, this is the finest silk." Yeah, and then access people. People like, "Oh, they don't want to say no."
Yeah,
it looks good, king. Everyone just, and I've seen that.
Right.
I want to digress. So there's this clip. It relates to this, but I saw it of this guy. He's a YouTuber, right? And he's in New York, Times Square. In the daytime, nothing, just a regular dude. Then he goes back at nighttime. It's actually in my story as well. If you go on my Instagram story, click on the highlights. It's the PSA, the public service announcement. So he goes at nighttime with entourage, with cameras, with everything. You've seen that clip, right? And then everyone's all on him. And then they're asking people, "So how do you know Jared? Oh, I liked him in Spider-Man. You know, I think it was." And no one wants to sound like an idiot, so they're all just lying. They're just making shit up. Yeah. And someone even said, like, "Oh, what do you think of his last album?" I didn't hear it, but... you know, I think I heard one of the singles on the radio. It's pretty good. It's pretty good. Like, everyone just want to seem like they know.
And this guy was just completely fake. Like, 100%. He just put on this facade where he just had this, like, glasses. He had the gears and he had bodyguards. He had an entourage. He had filmers. And he just walked out onto the street and everyone just thought that he was something.
Now, I was doing this photo shoot in Times Square. Same place. Same exact place. Times Square. This is before my New York fight. And I'm doing this photo shoot for my brand. Engage my peoples. And then... suddenly, I start to see through my peripherals, like, people gathering. And there's all these performers and stuff happening, but people starting to gather. And I'm just like, oh, no. And I kind of, like, deja vu, no way. I've seen this before. And before you know, I can see people talking, like, "What does he do? Who is he? What does he do?" And, "Hey, man, hey, I'm a big fan. Can I get a photo?" I'm like, "Yeah, sure." Well, I, like, just heard you 20 seconds ago going,
Who is this?
And I've seen it so many times. So it's that. Yeah, that mentality. People just want to belong. People want to find a way to kind of conform. And fuck, I digressed.
No, but it does make sense how you're talking about sort of like the king. He had this cloak or this robe, but he actually had nothing on. It took the kid to actually tell him, like,
because kids are honest. Like,
and you got to respect that, bro? 100%. You got to respect our youth and their freedom of thought, because they don't have any restrictions on them at the moment.
Yet,
they're not
hopefully.
Confined to society into sort of being morphed into thinking a certain way. And I think, you know, just going back to sort of what you're saying, especially how that guy just wanted a photo.
Yeah.
And we were talking about it earlier. People want to know you for their own sort of value. Like, look, I had a photo with Israel Adesanya, or I've had a photo with Pablo. You know, it's sort of like those types of things.
I haven't had people, I might have to say something soon, but it's happened like 4 times now where people drive by and just yell my name. And I'm just like, like, literally, I'm in the house and I'll hear it. It's like, "Stop, Brandon!" Like, you're freaking out the neighbors, first of all. And second of all, I might not be home. Maybe they see the car outside. But I'm like, okay, sure. I come here to kind of like this right here. This is my favorite spot in the world. This. Wherever in the world I go, I fantasize about this place, literally. After fights, I just think about coming back home. Even after holidays or during holidays, I'm like, I can't wait. As much as this is awesome, I can't wait till I come back home to this spot. So when I come here, and then like people are just trying to like, it's like, no one invited you. Like, you know, this is my bubble.
Yeah.
Like, I cherish that. I really, really cherish that. As much as it looks like I'm an extrovert, which I can be, because I'm a cusp. I'm a crab lion. I'm a Cancer Leo. So I go from like being sensitive and soft and to like this, you know, like sure of himself, confident,
certainty,
cocky, certain, very certain of himself, individual. So like in public eye, I can turn on my extrovertness and just be like, yo, and I cut promos and all that kind of shit. But then when I come to my, like, even Corbin, you know, Eden, friends of mine, they know how I am. Like, when I'm in my zone, I just And man. I can still like converse and stuff like that, but I really like my alone time. A lot of people don't value that these days. A lot of people, they're scared of their thoughts.
Right.
They're scared of where their brain goes. Like, once they start to, like, I have people I know who they need people around. Like, oh, what are we doing? What are we doing tonight? Or, you know, they need to have, I'm like, bro, can we just enjoy this?
Yeah, just the space.
Exactly. Like, yeah. I don't mind having someone just being around. Like, even just having Corbin sitting there, I'd be sitting here. We'll be watching the same show. He's on his laptop or whatever, and I'm just watching something, and it's just like just enjoying that company.
Yeah, exactly.
And sometimes we'll just chop it up for like hours, and yeah, I really appreciate the fact that I can kind of transcend between both.
It's just adaptability though, eh? Like, you know, you can't always be on. Like, that's just not humanly possible.
I reckon
you can't sustain that energy, you know, when you have to be on. And sometimes you just need that time to chill out. And and for me, you know, just being in this, trying to, like, you know, just try and execute on things.
Yeah.
You know, it's my darling. You know, it's my fiance. She's the person who, like, sort of brings me back into balance.
She grounds you.
She grounds me. Beautiful. She, like, she recenters me. You know, when I come home, it's sort of like, sweet, this is why I do the things that I do. But now she charges me up. You know what I mean?
Oh,
so that feels great, bro. But just touching back into just the way that you think, bro, because, you know, I've been, had the privilege of just, you know, just sharing really deep and meaningful conversations with you. And it's sort of like super challenging because you're, like you said, you're very curious.
Mm-hmm.
But what brings that out of you, bro? Like, what's that curiosity? Why do you feel like you always need to be challenged? Do you like the feeling of discomfort? Like, are you aware that you're just wanting
take
to
notes,
grow?
Interviewers, people in the MMA world, this is how you ask questions. We might not always have this kind of long form method, but a lot of times I look forward to, because you ask interesting questions. Now, my earliest memory of questioning authority, my earliest one was like maybe when I was 6 or something. And after Sunday school one day, I asked a teacher at Sunday school, like, wait, so if God created the world, who created God?
Yeah.
And I just remember, like, the dance around, and then I think I got a lolly and then sent me on my way. And then I asked my parents.
Got a lolly?
Yeah.
The strict UA. Adapting.
Actual. But then I asked my parents, and then they kind of didn't give me the right answers. And I asked my housemaids, I asked my aunties. And it wasn't until, like, maybe I asked for ages, like a whole week or even more. And until one of my aunties was like, look, if you keep asking that question, you're going to go crazy. You can't be asking that. I'm like, So that was my first inkling that, okay, these people probably don't know shit.
Yeah.
And then since then, I started to, like, question a lot of things over, not from there, like, that was my earliest memory, but then, like, from the age of maybe 16 or 17, I just questioned things like, why, you know, why do we go to school, you know? Then from the age of, like, 19, you know, why, I questioned, like work. Why do I have to do this 9-to-5 to, you know, work this way to get this money and then come back next week? Like, things like that, you know? And since then, I've just always questioned everything. Even now, like, it gets to the point where I question my emotions. Like, why am I feeling this way?
Right.
Like, example, okay, perfect story. Like, when Rob was working in the mines, I'm sure you were working in the mines as well. And when he first moved, I think I've told him the story. So, like, he wouldn't mind me sharing me. But, like, I remember, like, he was, you know, racking and making, like, $2,500 a week. And I just moved to Auckland. This was 2010. And he's like, bro, come to the mines. I got you. I can get you a job, this and that, rah. And I'm like, man, that seems nice. You know, like $2,500 a week for me at that time. Woo, man, that was nice. Even now, that's good for anyone. You know, and I thought about it, but I just moved to Auckland just so I can pursue this dream from Whanganui. You know, I just put everything in my car, drove to Auckland. And I'm like, I just got here. I can't just move to Australia. And I was like, oh. And my parents as well, they're like, oh, give it a year. See how you feel. They can go back and finish your degree.
Right.
And all, you know, Nigerian parents. And I remember, like, oh, I don't know if I want to go to the mines, but it was tempting. And then there was a period between, I can't remember when, but in 2010, 2011, where, like, whenever he either hit me up, I just kind of, like, you know, whatever. Yeah. Or like,
and I really came to the conclusion that that wasn't for you.
Yeah, but no, but for me, I was like, why am I feeling this way? It wasn't, it was like, I'd hit him up. I always feel this, I felt this type of way, but I was like, why am I feeling this way? And I was like, why am I jealous?
Mm.
Like, there's no need to be jealous. And it was, no, most people don't question that. They right. just accept that feeling, that emotion, and then that's it. Like, oh. And they'll make some excuse to why he's successful.
Right.
Know? So for me, I was like, why am I jealous? Like, he's not doing anything to me. He's not taking anything away from me. Like, this endless. Sky's not the limit. It's endless. There's enough out there. Even in the UFC, you see people now, they look at me, oh, he's only been here for, you know, 20 months. Why is you getting paid more? Why is you fighting for a title? I'm like, bro, I'm just doing my work. There's enough out there for everyone. Trust me. There's enough out there. And for me, I just had to learn. And that's why I questioned that emotion. Like, why am I jealous? I call that identifying the monster. You have to find the monster. Once you identify it and you make it bleed, you can kill it. So I was able to kill it, and then we're able to get back to our friendship. But that was a key moment for me where I realized, huh, I didn't know, like, you know, you can get that deep without even letting yourself sink that deep, you
right.
know? Like, you kind of just fall into the pattern. Like, because you've seen people just like, oh, they'll make excuses. Like, even me, oh, he's only good because he's tall. You know, he's only good because he's black. You know, right. I was like, no, I worked.
And they like to put that onto other people as opposed to like taking that accountability, that exactly. ownership of like, you know, yeah, he's tall, but like, why am I feeling this?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think that's such an important thing, bro. And just self-awareness, you know, just
objectivity, I say. Yeah. I'm a very objective person because I constantly just like, I'll sit there and watch myself like I'm David Attenborough watching some chimpanzee on National Geographic, and I watch my actions sometimes, and I'm just like, why are you like that? Why did he do that? You know? Like, from a third person point of view.
Yeah.
But I think it's healthy as well.
I think it is, bro.
To detach yourself and then, yeah, observe.
Just observe, bro. I think that's so important. And just doubling back to the question you asked that your elementary teacher, have you got like answer yourself, or just an idea?
Mm. My answer is no one knows shit. Honestly, I don't think anyone has the right, like, has the right or wrong answer. There's so many.
Because someone actually, like, hit me up, like, a few weeks ago. They asked, like, who created exact the same thing to me. So if God is God, or universe is universe, who created the universe, or who created God? And I was just thinking, I was like, far out. And I just watched like a video on something, and it was sort of like, fire can't burn itself, you know, like, you know, or a knife can't cut itself, you know. So it's sort of like, to me, when I'm thinking like, far, God can't, like, you know, create itself. It's just it.
Even like, kind of, I put it into this context. I was like, well, if the Big Bang created everything, what created the Big Bang?
Right. It's just one of those endless sort of rabbit hole sort of things, bro?
And for me now, I don't really have an answer. I'll never ever claim like I know the answer.
Yeah, I'm exactly.
But in my life, from what I've seen, is this? Oh, I can go deep. Is
this go weird? There, bro. Come on, this is it, bro.
Is this weird idea that I have in my head that I'm in the Matrix?
Right. Yeah.
And I said it after my New York fight as well. I keep going back to that. I said it like, you know, I'm player one, you know, and I started the game at level two. These boys are just loading. Everyone else is bots. And have you seen a Truman Show? With Jim Carrey?
No, I haven't.
Jim Carrey, it's an old movie. We watched it in high school, actually. And pretty much, he was an experiment. He was like a reality show. Everyone in his life was an actor. But then eventually, at one point, he started to like question like, huh. Yeah, I don't want to say the end of the movie, but pretty much he just had to, the movie was him discovering this world that he lived in, you know, that was fabricated to him. Like, each character was played with a certain purpose for him, you know, his parents, everything. So for me, sometimes, like, you met me before all this shit happens. So sometimes I get in this position, I'm just like, huh. I feel like him in the Truman Show. It even goes deeper to the point where, like, after my fight in New York, I remember I was flying back to LA, and on the plane, I astral projected, I lucid dreamed, and I think that happened for like a span of maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours, and I had this like this weird feeling I can never describe. I don't know how to describe it. Just the I don't think it was from the fight itself. I think just everything, all these emotions I was going through, just kickstarted this weird trip. But it just happened to be on the plane. Right. It was my first time alone in a long time, in a few days, just to be alone for a few hours. So then, yeah, I had this, and I swear it was astral projection because I was watching my sisters and brother fight in the airport in Texas about something, and it just felt like I was there.
Right.
You know what I mean? That was weird. And then lucid dreaming as well. I can't remember what the dream was exactly, but I was lucid dreaming about some other stuff. And
much leveling up after that fight, bro. It's just like you just morphed, you just evolved, you turned Ash, Super Saiyan, you know?
Ash, I told Ash after that fight, he watched it that whole fight week. I think that was the biggest I've had yet, like in media obligations, fandom, all that kind of stuff. So he watched me like just grow that week. And I told him after the fight, I feel myself leveling up right now. So I don't know what it was in my brain that was happening, what chemicals were like mixing together, but it was I will never forget that flight. And I remember I took some notes, I took some voice recordings just to remind myself, because certain things happen, I'm like,
happen?
Exactly. Later, in years, literally, I'll think about it, I'm like, that wasn't real, but I'm like, nah, lock it in. So I just lock it in.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was a special trip for me.
Bro, that's so mean. And, you know, just going back onto, you know, the Big Bang or the God, the universe, just sort of, I had one of these moments just yesterday, actually. Myself and my fiance were over in Tauranga, and we just went and like just connected with some awesome people, Summer and Daniel Bronze. Mm-hmm. And then after that, we went and climbed the mountain.
The mount.
So, and when we were up there, it was a beautiful afternoon, and they just got these rocks around sort of the peak, and you can just go and sit on them.
Yeah.
And taking photos, obviously. And I just remember we just sort of sat on these rocks, and we were just appreciating just the view. And I remember I just closed my eyes. My legs were just hanging over this edge, and I just closed my eyes, and I just started to tune into the sound, you know, just hearing the ocean. Hearing just the wind, hearing the trees just brushing against each other, hearing my own breath, you know, hearing people talking,
miles away.
And I just opened up my eyes, bro. And I just remember I just looked at Henipane, I was like, what are you grateful for? And she just said, this view. And I remember, bro, just sitting in this moment, and I had a tear down my face, actually. And she looked at me and she said, are you crying? And I didn't acknowledge it. I just sort of went into, you know, like if the universe, if God, if the creator can create this ocean that my ancestors, that Māori saw as a connector between islands, between other indigenous groups. If the universe, God, the creator can create these trees, or it can create this wind that is not only touching my face, but touching people around the world that has traveled, why can't it manifest my dreams?
Wow.
You know, it's so insignificant. Really, my dreams, what I have in my mind for our future, it's so insignificant to the creation of nature. You know, and I had that profound sort of realization because I decided to go in and tune in. You know, and I think it's similar to you when you're by yourself and you can really just start to really follow your thoughts to a space of where you've arrived, you know, to a realization, to maybe even a more developed question. You know, maybe a new
sometimes
question that you need to ask.
It brings up more questions than answers, and you're like, okay, let's sit down, let's buckle
up. So, and I just remember just sitting there, bro, and I was just like, man, we're just so blessed. We live in New Zealand, bro, where we can actually experience this. You know, and I think for me in that moment, there was just a lot of certainty in myself and confidence that I was like, shucks, man, like, this is it. And I looked at it, I say it all the time, bro, like, we're going to have an amazing future.
Yeah.
Like, we say that to each other and so much, like, confidence. So just doubling it back to that, bro, just to, like, plug in that little story, because I think it's just important for us to be present.
Yeah.
You know,
I practiced that for a little bit, and I
because you go for like nature walks in that.
I'm blessed in a way where like literally over there is just like a reserve that I can take the dogs to. Used to take the cat to as well, but then even like when I'm jet lag, I get back home bare feet, you know, and I walk through the land, you know, put my foot in the water in the creek, stand there, even if it's cold, just feel it, embrace it, and try and be present. And it's really hard to do. Even when I was practicing mindfulness meditation was something I practiced for a few months on and off. But then, yeah, it's always hard to try and kind of stay here, because you'll be here in the present moment watching your breath, and then it'll just veer off into right. something else. And then, it's really hard. That's but tough. practice yeah. makes perfect. And there's times where I get to that point where I'm just present. And yeah, for me, it's paramount that I'm a person that just stays in the moment. You can never ever have anything just, especially in the cage. That's yeah. one thing. Like one thing I love to do when I if you ever watch my next fight, well, don't just look at me. Look at my eyes.
You'll recognize me. Bro, you're just like yeah. zoned in. Like honestly, bro, like
it's so weird. Even watching it, I'm like,
the frick out, bro. You know, standing in a cage yeah. with someone where you literally, it's sort of like you're literally dying there. Mm-hmm. And it's the mentality that you're yeah, in.
I had
you're
that.
Fighting
man.
For your life.
There's man. Levels. I had that in my last one when, before, because, you know, the fight, the first round was the first time I ever got dropped in the UFC fight. I didn't even get dropped, I got rocked. And then I caught myself, circle back to the center, do some work. I lost the round. The second round, you know, I'm doing some work, he's doing some work, then I drop him, boom. And then I'm winning the round. And then third round, I school him, hit him with like some crazy spinning back elbow, rocked yeah. him. You know, he tried to take me now, stuffed him, rocked him again, which is peppering him up. And fourth round, I was doing the same thing, you know, peppering him up, peppering me up. And then he threw like a masterful move where he just threw a head kick, but he hit it behind a punch. Yeah. And I never, the whole camp, I was like, he doesn't throw head kicks. Like, I just didn't have that. I knew obviously he can, but he doesn't throw it. It's not yeah. in his arsenal. And that was a beautiful chess move on his part. So he rocked me, and then, you know, he won that round. So now we're 2-2 going into the fifth round. And the fifth round, I remember I looked him in the eye across the cage, and I remember his face as well. He looked like, in my head, I call it Ese Diablo. I know that, I think that's Spanish for the devil, because he looked like the devil. And I was looking at him, I was like, you're not going to beat me. I'm ready to die. And every time I say that, I still get that feeling. I still get chills. And it's hard for people like my mom to hear, because they're like,
Yeah.
What?
But that was real for you, eh?
It was real. Like, if I was like, if this is me, if this is how I go out, if after this, if maybe I got knocked down in that fifth round and then I never wake up, I know I gave everything. I know I put it all on the line. But on the flip side, if it happened to him, I would have been like, fuck, that sucks, you know, guilty, you know, like sucks, you know. And I wouldn't be like a criminal or anything like that, but it would have been like, well, I was ready to give something up. So yeah. you have to, I was ready to kill. If I was ready to die, I was ready to kill as well. And I was trying. That fifth round, like I hit him with like a guy, he's a Mexican warrior. Yeah. He's never been, I don't think he's only lost once at middleweight, and he's never been rocked or dropped. And I dropped him how many times? Like so many times. And I was trying to put the work on him. And that fifth round as well, I found a new level. Like, I looked fresher than I did in the first round.
Yeah.
You watch my fight, like, I was just rolling him. And I was calling him on, like, come on, let's go. And just rolling, rolling, rolling. And I went to this place of just darkness, just oneness. It was like it's almost autopilot, because I wasn't really in control. I was in control, but it was just like this.
It's like
this,
that third person again, bro, eh?
Exactly. Like, it was like a game. That's yeah. what I mean. Like the Matrix. I was just like, this is really you. And then after that fight, I remember, like, because after they called on, because I dropped him in the last 10 seconds.
Yeah.
And then that was another one. And then, like, I was trying, I hit him with this punch from heaven. Just, connected. And then I tried to finish him. And then after the fight, we just slumped all of each other. And I looked at him and I was like, yeah. Like, we both looked at each other like, yeah. We're smiling. Then I made sure I was like, get up and put your hands up, because you won that. And then maybe about a minute and a bit after that, the final round, I remember like checking my breath, like, oh, I can go another round. Like, literally, I thought that was me. Like, after that fight, I was like, man, I'm done. It's over. So that's why people say, oh, the sky's the limit. I'm like, no, it ain't. Yeah. There's way more. You don't even know. Like, even Bruce Lee said, there's never, excuse me, I can't quote the quote, something about it. There's never a final plateau, but that you always have to look for the next plateau. There's always another one.
Right.
And another one.
Levels.
And another. Levels, man. New levels, new devils. And Yeah, I'm trying.
I remember bloody watching that bloody 5 rounds, just watching it on my phone. I was legit just jumping around like yelling. It was legit, like so many roller coasters. Like
it's even worse when you know the person as well. Yeah, when you know the person, it's the worst. Because I feel the same thing when my friends fight. Like if you had a fight, I would palms sweaty, mom spaghetti, everything. Yeah. I'd be freaking I would have a hard time. So it's always harder for someone watch someone that you like fight or someone that you care about. But for me, I know how to control my emotions, so when I fight, I'm just like, whatever. But even Huge, my coach, his last fight, I remember, like, there's times when I'd be talking to him or, like, I'd be around him, but I start to feel nervous, so I'll just walk away.
Right.
I'll literally walk away just because I don't want to bring that.
Cause
like, because I can see him just, like, sitting down, calm, chilling, and I'm just like, okay, I'm out. And I'll come back maybe 10 minutes later when I've, like, let all that, you know, juju go or whatever. I remember I asked him, I was like, why are you so calm? This is years ago. And I asked him, why are you so calm? He said, why wouldn't I be? I was like, yeah, you just seem really calm. He's like, well, I've done all the work. You know, I've done all the work. I made sure I did all the work. Now, you kind of just have to surrender.
Yes.
You
know what I mean?
Like, you have the vision of victory in your mind. You have, you know, being successful and everything. But you have to surrender to the will of the creator, the, you know, the God, the universe, and just like
the
whatever
process.
And people always say that, you know, it is, it's in God's plan. I know where that comes from, and sometimes people use it as a cop out, and I'm like, nope, you can't use that as a cop out. But I understand the process. Like you said, let the chips fall where they may. It is God's plan. It wasn't meant to be right there and then, or it was, but there's a moment where you just have to surrender and just let it go. And I've been visualizing that for this camp. I already picked my track for what I'm going to walk out to, because the stadium, I've been there before. I was there in UFC 193 when Ronda fought Holly Holm. I was there, like, in the nosebleeds, like, all the way up in the back. So I know the feeling. There's a guy that came out to AC/DC, for those about to rock. He came out to that, and I remember the feelings in the speakers. So I've already picked my track. And every time after, like, a hard training, when I drive home and I'm playing it, and I visualize my walkout, I visualize just this letting go. I just visualize just letting go. Like, you can't have any thought of, oh, what is, you know, what does this person think? Or what if I do this? You just have to let go and just surrender. Just surrender to it, you know? And I've had experience with that in the past on a lot of things, and I'm sure you have as well. Just surrendering to the will and just,
sort of like the thing that sort of comes to the surrender, another way it says, like, fuck it. You
exactly.
know? It's sort of, that's just another way of, like, surrendering is just like, oh, well, what do you got to lose? It's
exactly.
one of those sort of things, and just doing your best. And as long as you show up with your best, then, like, how can you be mad? And I don't know what it's like at a professional level, but people who do take a loss at that level, it can be tough, right?
Oh, yeah, I've seen it. The highs, oh, my God, the highs are so beautiful. I keep talking about New York and that high on the plane. Like, I wasn't on anything, but, like, for me to astral project and all that kind of stuff, lucid dream, like, I felt like I was on the... Like, I was on the highest high, and I was in the sky as well, so I was high. But there's the lows, and, like, there's the ones where I've seen it, and I've experienced it, where it's just like, like, I remember my first Super 8 when I lost it. I won the fight, I thought, the first round, but then they gave it to the Aussie. And then you already kind of know this, like, there's a lot of fuckboys and basic bitches around, and it's just kind of like...
Right.
I'm like, oh, and then you... It's just you and your core people, and then they check up on you, they make sure you're all right, they still stick with you. But then sometimes, like back then, I'd isolate myself even more, and I remember just like the lows get low, man, like so low. And it just, it takes it takes a strong person to get through those. So that's just why this game, it's not for the faint-hearted, man. And I've had friend, you know, a friend lose their life in this. So when people put everything on the line, it's for real. It's for real. They put everything on the line, and it's just, it's a privilege though, just to be able to do this, man. Like sometimes I have to pinch myself.
Because it's an art at the end of the day,
Mixed martial arts,
martial arts.
And you even watch the way I fight. If you understand,
and you get a lot of inspo from cartoons, eh?
Yeah, 100%. Like Avatar, Naruto, Mortal Kombat. You know, Tekken, like video games, things like that. Like, I like to express. I was actually studying to be a graphic designer, an animator. Like, that was my thing. I studied that for about 3 years, and I had one more year to, like, finish the whole thing, but I just felt like, man, I will do it later on, I think. I wanna have my own production studio, but just to, like, hire people who are smarter than me to bring my ideas to life.
Right.
But for me, it's just, Yeah, I like looking at things differently, and I like cartoons because there's no limit, you know.
Yeah,
there actually is no limit. Like, you can look at SpongeBob. You know, the whole story itself is a talking crab, is a squirrel, a scuba on the water, is a star that lives under a rock. Like, there's no limit. You can make whatever you want to make. So that's why I vibe with a lot of cartoon characters, and I tattoo some of them on me. I embody them on me because of how they made me feel growing up in certain eras of my life, you know. And yeah, certain things I'll just take with me to the grave. I'll never die. I'll never grow old.
Yeah. And just because I think some things we do forget as we get older is to tap back into our younger selves, into our kid. And I heard this real profound story. This minister, he's committed his life to a minister. I think he's a minister in his teens. His name's Father Richard Raw. Mm-hmm. Like, I really, I don't States really, I think he's over in the States.
Okay.
But I love listening to him. Like, he's a minister. But like, I just take the language that I want to take out of it.
Yeah, 100%.
But one of these stories, and I was listening to his podcast, what he was saying is, he wrote in his book the story of there was a 3-year-old, mm-hmm. 3 or 4-year-old boy. His parents came home with their newborn. And when his parents walked in, this 3 or 4-year-old boy said to his parents, can I talk to my little brother? And they're like, yeah, sure. And he was just like, alone. So they trusted him. They put them in the room, and they put like a cup. The parents put a cup on the door to hear what he had, what they were going to talk about or what he wanted to say. And he said when his parents left, he just went to his little brother, where did you come from? Because I'm forgetting.
Oh, wow.
Well, right?
Wow.
He asked his little brother
where
he came from because he was forgetting.
That's crazy. That actually just gave me chills.
Because that sort of shows, you know, because we come into this existence with a consciousness, right? Mm-hmm. You know, we come into this space, into this existence, sort of already knowing who we are.
Yeah.
After we sort of... after we're born, you know, after we get all these conditions, we're trying to find our way back to that point.
Yeah.
So even at a really young age, 3 or 4 years old, this young boy started to feel like he was getting detached or becoming disconnected from the source.
Yeah.
So it's like when you're sort of talking about you getting into cartoons, that's a way that you can tap back into your source. So it's all about, also another friend of mine articulated this meme. Like, when we're young, we already have a good sense of who we are. When we're older, sort of like looking at it as timeline, we sort of become closer to who we are because we're going, it's that circle.
Yeah.
But in the sort of middle part where we start to ask the big questions.
Oh, you mean older as in like old age?
Old age. Okay,
yeah.
Sorry.
Okay, yeah. I get you.
You know, I've seen that it's even. Sort of that circle of life.
They have diapers on, shit themselves all the time. You know,
Then in this middle bit, we're sort of asking ourselves the bigger questions, like, what is life? What is my purpose? What is my legacy? And we're asking those questions is because what we're seeing, it's a midlife crisis.
Yeah.
Because we're in the middle where we don't know who we are, but we're still far away from returning.
Yeah.
Back you to know, where we so were. It's sort of like that midlife crisis.
That's crazy. I never thought about it like that.
Because it's in that sort of sense. It could be.
Yeah.
This was just a sort of chopping up of thoughts that, and when you're sort of looking at it in that broader sort of viewpoint, it's sort of like you start to see the connections.
Yeah, but I like that. Even for me, I make a correlation between, I'll tell you the story to a few people, and probably on my Instagram, you've heard about me talking about a metamorphosis. There was, when I turned 28, I had this metamorphosis. It was literally like, as soon as I turned 28, I just, everything made sense. I had this one night where I was just dancing in my old flat, tinier space than that kitchen, and like I was just dancing and like for about 2 hours, and just at one point I just let go, and I remember this feeling of just flowing for like a straight 20 minutes, like, you know, like before I was just labbing kind of like for about 2 hours labbing, but there was this like 20-minute stretch where I was just dancing and flowing in my room, and it was just beautiful. It was just me, you know. And after that, I felt like things started to make sense. Things started to fall into place. Bits and pieces. People leaving your life. People coming into your life. And I think that was my first taste of being an adult, quote unquote.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, oh, I'm starting to figure this out. That was kind of the time where I started to actually like question like the whole Matrix thing. Like, am I in the Matrix? Like, who's playing this? Because sometimes I feel like a vessel, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Things just come and I'm like, where did that come from? And, you know, you feel like you're just a character in the game. But even trying to get more in touch with not just my youth, like I use that through dance, through crump. Like, I left dance for so long just because I got sick of the politics. I got sick of people, who's this, who's this? You know, I'm the best, I'm this. I'm like, ugh, I just want to dance, I just want to have fun. And I found myself like that metamorphosis while I was dancing back to my youth, back to my, you know, my culture in a way. Something that, and I felt like using that brings you back to the source through dance, through cartoons, and even going back to Nigeria as well. Like, for me, it was one of the ultimate, like, deja vu experiences going back to my old primary school.
Yeah.
And like, literally, it was just, I saw one teacher that my parents used to make me go live with him during the week. And then the weekends, I go back home because I was just so spoiled. Like, I was spoiled as a kid. So I just was doing bad in school, all this kind of stuff. So they made me live with my teacher. And I just thought he would have left the school. But I saw him, man. It was like seeing a ghost. And then walking around the school, everything seemed so small. And then, you know, you're seeing places that I used to hide over there when I was, you know, playing hide and seek. That was one of my other hiding spots. And you just seen like things. It was a weird experience, but I was really grateful for it. But it was, in a sense, physically going back to your roots, like to your childlike state, you know, and being there. There was even a point, like, I went to the kindergarten I used to sit at, and they were doing like some kind of play or reading or whatever. And I sat there about a good 5 minutes. I forgot about all the other people behind me that followed me, like all the principals and adults. I just sat there until one time, like, I think someone tapped me and was like, you gotta go. And I was like, oh yeah, oh, okay. And I had to leave, but I didn't want to leave. I was just sitting there watching these kids read, you know, and learn how to read. And I was just, it was cool. But I like that story. I'm going to ponder more about that. Like,
bro,
where
I think
did you,
it's just
where
cool.
Did, what did it say? Where did you come from? I'm starting to forget.
Yeah.
They've even talked about kids recognizing the different faces of lemurs. You know how, like, to us, we'll look at a lemur and like, oh, just another lemur. They all look the same. But they've done tests where they look at, you know, the kids can recognize, like, that lemur, I know that one, just by the face.
Yeah.
But as they get older, they lose that sense as well of being able to recognize them. They don't know what it is. This is so many unanswered questions. They never know what it is, but that's what that reminded me of, but on a deeper level.
I think sometimes when we don't know what it is, sometimes it's okay to not know as well.
I just say, I don't know.
Yeah, exactly right, eh?
Because everyone wants to act like, oh, I know it. I'm like, you know, I don't know.
And sometimes we want to know what we can see, but sometimes there's that unseen space, you know, whereas if we tune into that unseen, maybe we'll be able to detect, oh, that's that lemur, that's that. But if we're just taking it for physical...
Face value,
I think that's where we get the confusion happening because... We can't adjust too quickly, but if we just tap in and feel, you can definitely feel the different energy from the different sort of lemurs or whatever it may be.
I had a thought the other day, yesterday actually, because I was toothless, my Roddy. I was looking at her and I was like, oh, she's so beautiful. Like, she's a little shit sometimes, but I was like, man, she's so beautiful. Look at her. And I was like, I wonder if I'll be able to tell the difference between her and other Rottweilers, and instantly, yes, because I saw another Rottweiler at the park.
Right.
So that's why I was like, man, is that what she's going to look like when she's fully older? And that thought just came into my head, and I was like, I might YouTube that. So yeah, I was wondering if like maybe I'd be able to tell the difference between her and a pack and other dogs if they just sat there. And instantly, I was like, yep, like instantly. But I like what you said about it's the energy. Like, no one, we're looking at it face value. Like, I'm looking at, oh, but I'm sure, like, if I look at her, like, oh, there's Toothless. If she can't see me, like, behind the screen door and she's just moving around and, like, there's a pack of 10 Rottweilers just moving, I'd be able to be like, yep, that's my one. Literally, I just know her mannerisms. If I can smell, maybe not the smell, but just I can see her and just be like, yep, that's her. So maybe that's, yeah.
Just tapping more into that, eh? And honestly, just same on that, sticking on that same thread. Like, I know something that you're super connected to, and that's like, you're always interested in Māori, eh?
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the culture.
The culture, yeah.
Is that because you know what culture's coming from, where you're from? But what makes you acknowledge sort of Māori? Is it how you grew up in Rotorua and Whanganui? Like, yeah, where does
for
that come
me,
from?
For me, in this country, New Zealand, I look at, if I compare New Zealand to, like, say, somewhere like America, you look at the Māori is like the black people, the Pakeha as like the colonizers, the white people, and then you look at like say the islanders as the Mexicans, the ones that immigrate. So even just coming to New Zealand, moving to New Zealand, I was 10 and I asked my dad, where's that? Is that a new country? Because I was quite naive. I didn't know where it was. And casting my mind back now on ESPN back in Nigeria years ago on ESPN, I saw this white guy on the ad doing the haka. And I was like, the fuck is that? Like, why is this guy? Because he was just dressed like a proper golfer. Right. Like, come out there. What the? And I was like, okay, that's weird. But then living in Rotorua and then being immersed in the culture itself, you know, Rotorua is like the hub, the Bear Plenty. And even being part of the inter-house competitions, like the haka competitions, getting to learn the chants, the songs, getting to learn how to do the haka itself, the school haka. And they even used to put me in the front because, you know, that international flavor.
You know,
like, oh, look at this black kid going hard. Oh, snap. But, like, you get to embrace it a lot more and get to appreciate it for what it is. And one thing I always like is the switch. Like, I have seen you. Look at you right now. You're chilling. But then if it's time to do a haka, I like to see that.
Yeah.
That switch. And I don't know what that comes from. But for me, it reminds me of Crump. Like, when I see someone just, like, suddenly chilling but then dancing and wilding out and letting out this raw emotion of just everything and just giving their all, like their spirit, like giving everything. I've seen some hakas where guys are like frothing at the mouth. I'm like, oh snap, this guy's going in. And it just, every time, there's no time a haka doesn't give me chills.
Yeah,
you know, and just that appreciation, it's just raw, it's primal. Something about that just like I can connect to as a person, as a human, not even as a Kiwi, but like just as a human, just that primal rawness of that itself, that's one thing that I really appreciate. And the culture, for me, talking to a guy like Shane, you know Shane Young?
Yeah.
Friend of mine, yeah, he's cool. He's a guy that really, really pushes the culture forward, you know, no matter what anyone says or anything. He's a guy that constantly pushes the culture forward and rides for the people. And talking to him a little bit, and other friends as well, you kind of get to learn, like even right now with Ihumato. Like, I didn't know what it was till another friend of mine put me onto it. Then I asked Shane a little bit more about it. Like, what's happening? And he told me about Fletchers and the land and all this kind of stuff. And I was like, damn. And then after about 2 weeks, you know when it was like, it was up the top?
On the peak.
Yeah. Then after, I was like, is that still going? He's like, yeah. And then I saw like, oh, he's still going. Like, it's just like, there's the wave. Because, you know, for me, I didn't want to be that guy like, just like, I don't like to like, just do all these like social media, what do you call it? Just to do it. Like, I want to be a guy that's actually, if I'm going to do something, I'll put my foot on the ground and do it.
Yeah.
You know? And I can show support on social media. Don't get me wrong. Bring awareness to things. I like to do that as well. But I don't want to do it just because everyone's
just
doing it.
Yeah.
So after about 2 weeks when it kind of died down, I asked him, he's like, yeah, it's still going on. It just sometimes needs a re-up. He said, eventually, there's going to be another time. And he says, till this day, there's still people out there protecting the land.
Yeah.
And they take shifts and they're just looking after, you know,
what's going on.
Exactly.
Yeah,
the officers are still there, all this kind of stuff. And I'm like, man, that's crazy how it kind of just like, and then goes away,
you know? And then comes back.
Yeah,
and that's something that, you know, it's sort of like the modern day sort of colonizing
story.
Sort of colonizing story. But, you know, the people who are there on the land, on the whenua, I think there's some discussions happening, so there is sort of progress.
Because Jacinda doesn't say anything for ages.
No.
So that was one thing I was wondering as well, because I really valued her. I didn't really like, I don't follow politics.
No, neither.
I follow, like, say, maybe I have to follow fight politics because I'm in the sport, but, like, regular politics, I don't even bother about. But, like, when the whole attack in Christchurch happened in the mosque, the way she handled it, I was like, man, that's a leader. That's cool. I really respected that. And then when this happened with, you know, the Modi people, I was like, oh, she hasn't said anything yet. So I was constantly like, because I was following it like on the low, but I don't have, and it's just like, she hasn't said anything yet.
Sort of like,
so I was like, there's someone else above sort of, her, you know, that has a big say all around, that advises not to say anything about it. But yeah, I don't know. I think I heard in the end she kind of said that they're looking into it or they're trying to work it out.
Yeah,
but that just seems like yeah, money talks. At
something's
the end of
happening
the
there, eh? But yeah, like honestly, bro, I bring that up because I remember, you know, the times that we have connected, and you know, I've been on my journey, and like I'm always like,
watch.
And I'm always
even
like
your
trying
trips,
to feed
remember,
you.
Like there was the trips you were doing in Southeast Asia.
Yeah, bro.
I loved watching those, man.
Bro,
I loved
honestly,
watching those.
I remember you was like, you should start a YouTube channel.
Yeah, that was at the bar. Yeah. That bar, like,
yeah, that's right.
Yeah, I used to eat at.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then we chopped it up. Yeah, we've connected like bits and pieces over the years. Yeah, that was
there.
That time. But I remember I was like, yeah, that was cool. Because you went with, what was your boy's name?
Denim.
Denim, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
That's right. But I remember you saying, like, start a YouTube channel. And then when we last connected, you know, I had started one by then, and we just like full circle type thing. But, you know, I've been on my sort of journey, but, you know, I'm always like trying to like share stuff. And I remember, like, you know, what I was learning at the time just about around Te Ao Māori, but I just remember you just being so engaged. Like,
were you and Ra talking? There was that bit.
There was me and
I
Ra
remember
talking.
You guys were talking, you're speaking in Te Reo, and I was just like,
But you're just like in it. And then
I was just
sharing. Like,
even just the tone. Like, for me, because my language is quite tonal. Yoruba is quite a tonal language. And a lot of people sometimes, even when you ask like a Pakeha to say like a Māori word, it's like you're not saying it right. You know, like my language, you have to sing it in a way.
Right.
Yeah. Like you have to. And I appreciate that kind of stuff. Like when I was just watching URI talk, and I remember I was a little bit lit, but I was just like, man, that's cool. Like you guys are just like, everyone else is speaking English, but you guys just having your own little language. So even now with me and my boy, AB Abiola, he's in my crew. He went to Nigeria with me, but he's one of my best friends here. But because he speaks better Yoruba than me, I try and speak Yoruba with him. I try and speak Pidgin English with him. I try and speak, you know, in a Nigerian tone with him sometimes, just so I don't lose that. So I don't lose it from my culture, you know. Because from a kid coming from that part of the world, sometimes you look at TV, you look at, you know, all these movies and shows you watch, and you're like, man, I can't wait till I go to America. I can't wait till I go to that side of the world and then taste that. And then, you know, you come, we're meant to move to the States, but then in 2001, 9/11 happened. So we're like,
nah, we're not going there.
Yeah. So then moving here, and then having to, you know, live in this life, being in the Western world. Like I said, around 28, this metamorphosis happened and everything started to like make sense in a way. Like I started to even get back in touch with my roots, with my culture, not just through dance, but just through culture itself. Like trying to speak Yoruba a little bit more with people who understand it, trying to eat more Nigerian food, trying to just like connect back to the roots. That's one thing I really appreciate. And it's such a catch 22. Like, you know, you thought the grass would be greener on the other side, but it's not. Like even now you look at the culture, like pop culture. Something like Afrobeat is hot, you know, Wizkid, Davido, like everyone is like plugging into the culture that I'm from, you know, to try and be cool in a way. So for me, I'm just doing it for me though.
Yeah.
Like I booked, I think three, come. He asked for permission first, come. He knows he's not allowed without permission. Good boy. I booked like three different trips to Europe. I was like, man, I really want to see Europe. And this is like, then I think the New York fight happened. Then, okay, I'm going to go to Europe. And then, get silver fight. And I was like, okay, I'm going to go to Europe. And then, okay, interim title. All right, get that done. And eventually I was just like, screw this trip. Something was just calling me back to go back to Nigeria. Like something was just telling me, you need to go back home and touch the soil. You need to go back home and just connect with your people a little bit more. You need to go back home and just feel like the culture, you know, and that's, I'm glad I went. I was like, my choice was like, yeah, Europe is always going to be there. Like, you know, and everyone, like, I think because of, I was following people, not following, but I've seen people, it looks beautiful. Like, you know, Italy, people going to the Colosseum, that's like, everyone's done that. And I'm like, I haven't done that yet, but I've, you know, I was like, nah, I want to go back to Nigeria. I really, and I'm so glad I went. It was one of the best trips of my life. Like,
bro, could see it. Like, you could just see that you're just like, you were yourself, you know, your true self.
I was vibing,
connecting with your people.
Even being on the beach, I was being on a horse, and I watched that clip now, and it's just like, it's still me. Don't get me wrong, but it's like you're seeing a different side of me. Like I'm chopping up with my people in their own native tongue, and it's just, it was cool to see. Like, oh yeah, it's still in me. Like literally within like 3 days, I started like, you know, my Nigerian accent started to like kind of roll out again. I started speaking more, Pidgin English. I started like my Yoruba was getting better and better day by day. So it's just the adaptability, like being, and it's already in me as well. So for me, watching that from a third person, like watching it on my Instagram, when I was like, oh, that's cool. Like it brings me joy.
Yeah.
I can't wait to
just reawakening, man. And I also remember that night, bro, we like made a pact.
Yeah.
Remember that pack where you would go in like to an elderly home and then I'd go and visit my nan more?
I remember
you shared me a photo and you said you had done it, like you stuck to your word. But what did you learn in that experience, bro?
So my mom used to work at an elderly home and she told me some of the horror stories whenever, like sometimes I hear her and my dad talk when I was a kid about some of the horror stories that happened there. Like literally people would just, workers there would just leave, you know, someone's nan to sit in their shit for 30 minutes during their break. Like, oh, it's my break. I don't want to clean this now. I'm going to take my break first. And my mom, she got a secret pay rise even that other workers didn't know about back then, because she, in our culture, she treated people's parents like the way she'd treat her parents. You know, so she would care for them and look after them and all that kind of stuff. And for whatever reason, I just never like... I've been around old people and stuff like that. Don't get me wrong, but like I never like had the inkling. And I had a friend who used to do it all the time, and she invited me once, and I was like, nah, it's not my thing. I don't want to go see some old people. Like I didn't think I was really young, but then for I think talking with you, and you were talking about your nan. Was it your nan you're talking about? And I was like, I can't remember where the conversation led, but I remember like I was like, okay, the relationship you had with your nan, I was like, my grandparents are dead, but I can still connect with some old people. And I've always known, like, they're wise. They've been around for years. They can tell you some shit. But what I learned when I went there, man, it was kind of sad, to be honest, because a lot of these people just want someone to talk to.
They just,
literally, they just want someone to talk to, someone just to listen. You never have to say anything. Hi, how are you? Boom, that's 10 minutes gone.
Yeah.
Literally. Like, and they're just lonely. So it's kind of sad just to see. But I had a good time. Like, in the lunchroom, I had a good time. We played some games, flirt with some old ladies. They always like that. They'll give me the eye, man. But, like, it was just a lot. Bro,
you
like,
learn so much. Like, me life and Henry, lessons. Just me and life Henry lessons. Were, like, playing tennis, bro.
Yeah,
we're playing tennis. Just
yeah, you got
like,
into that for a bit, didn't you?
Yeah, well, we still play it, you know. Yeah, damn. Like just a few weeks ago, get better? We were there. Yeah, getting better. Yeah, like we're just having longer rallies and you know, just puffing away. But it's so much fun. But we're there, and this old man came through, and he was like, "Oh, this might sound funny to you, but it's not to me. You have your memory, but I've lost mine. I think I'm losing mine."
You know,
that's what he said to us, and he just asked if we could ring an ambulance. And so me and Honey, like, and this old man, like,
what
he's
was
always,
happening?
He was sweet, like, he was coherent, but he just felt that he was just losing memories there.
Like, short-term memory, like, he's losing.
No, it wasn't short-term memory, it was more, like, long-term, like, he just felt that he was starting to forget things that he's once remembered, and he just couldn't think about those things. Like, he knew where his address was.
Kind of like that kid.
Yeah, well, in a way. But he ended up asking us to ring an ambulance, and Honu rang the ambulance, and we're just sitting there, and we're just talking. Like I said, he was coherent. And we're like, oh, do you want us to ring? Like, do you have any family around? And he was like, I have a daughter, but she lives away, and she's not coming back. And like me and Honu, bro, like we legit, when he left, we just almost wanted to cry because, like, you know, that's real sad getting to that stage in your life and you really have no one.
Yeah.
Even like your kids are sort of like out doing life and there's...
She's not coming back.
They're not coming back. No. You know, like that's a real sort of tough thing to hear, you know, and sort of that's what I appreciate about, you know, Māori, about Indigenous people is we really value our old people.
Yeah.
You know, like we're always with them, you know, all the time. So for me, just hearing this, you know, there was just that realization, like far out.
Yeah.
It just encourages you to be a good human being, you know, because I think the better that you are, you're always going to have someone around you who cares for you. And I think that was the realization that we got just with this old man. And the ambulance came, like he was nice. We don't know actually what had happened, but we just felt like, oh, we done the right thing by doing that. And just got our realization from it. Yeah, but, you know, like you learn so much from our old people. And, you know, my grandmother just passed away this year, my last one. And, you know, I was stoked because after our conversation, I did start to go and see her a little bit more.
Yeah.
And like you said, you just need to sit there.
Yeah.
You know, you just sit there and they just go.
And, you can go back and forth with them as well.
And they repeat the same thing. But also, I think the other thing that we also said they would do together is go on a silent retreat.
Yeah, you know that was a Vipassana.
Yeah.
See, I was my first time I was supposed to go to was after my first King in the Ring, because I was like, ooh, in my head, I was like, oh, okay. I got this 10 grand. I need to just like, just don't touch it and just go to this retreat and just zone out, really meditate. But then the timing never happened. What's his name? Anthony Johnson called me to help him with like the John Jones fight.
Right.
So I was like, okay, go there. And then still to this day, I find bits and pieces of it. Like I said, I like being by myself.
Yeah.
But that retreat, like, you know Sonny Bishop?
Yeah.
He did it and he told me like, man, it was one of the hardest things I've ever done, but one of the most like
rewarding
ever. So that was already appealing to me. So I was like, man, I'd love to do that one day.
And it's now, just the intent, eh, bro? Yeah. Like when you're going into something with a bit more intent, like you're intentional about making that decision, about being in that environment, I think you're always going to get a return on that.
Yeah.
You know, but I think sometimes you really just have to block out that time, depending on the moment and time that you're in. You know, I think we rock in different seasons. Mm. Sometimes in the seasons where we need to just go out and be aggressive and try and elevate consciousness or serve, you know, there's other seasons where we just need time with family. You know, and we can experience these seasons in one day, but sometimes it comes down to where are we at right now in life? Do I need to contribute my time to being still? Or do I need to maximize with this energy that I have to go out and do what
burn
I need to
the
do?
Fire. Yeah. Mostly for me, right now, I find times. And one thing, Theo, a friend of mine, I met through VDK as well, he tells me randomly before he leaves, he'll just be like, hey, remember to find stillness in the midst of all this. And he'll just say that before he leaves. Like, after you say, goodbye, my bro, appreciate you. Remember to find stillness in the midst of all this. I'll be like, I do. But I like the fact that he just reminds me because it's crazy. Like, people forget. People just think it's all fun and games. That's why I even say, like, I sound like I'm complaining a lot sometimes. Like, first world problems. Trust me. I was just in Nigeria. I was in Makoko. I saw some stuff, like, people shouldn't even see. Like, the poverty level is so deep. So sometimes when I complain, I hear myself, and I'm like, ugh, such a bitch. Why are you complaining? Like, I am grateful, don't get me wrong. But something like me just wanting some peace in my own house away from all the fandom.
You know?
And someone driving by my house and yelling, all that kind of stuff. It's like, I'd just rather just not.
Yeah.
There's a quote that, you know, I've said. I was like, fuck fame, but I love the perks.
Yeah.
Like, I don't like being famous.
Yeah.
You think you want it? Honestly, like, I'm telling you, man. Like, as a kid, man, I remember, like, just...
idolizing people.
Oh, bro. Like, MTV Cribs. Oh, Pimp My Ride, all that kind of stuff. We grew up in that era.
Yeah.
Like, literally, we grew up in that era. So, for me, I always thought, like, I'm going to have 10 cars, you know, I'm a superstar, I'm gonna have this many houses. Houses is different now because I do it for business reasons, but like, I'm gonna have this many cars because that's the era we grew up in, Pimp My Ride, you know, looking, we're watching guys like Floyd Mayweather, seeing how they do things, and it goes to the point where I'm just like, nah, I just like my ride. Because I've got this fucking, was it Pathfinder, and I've had that since 2015 or 16. And then after the silver fight, they gave me a Range Rover to drive around in. And I was like, man,
this is nice.
I might get one of these. I'm going to get one of these when I get back. Even Eugene, my coach, was like, he's going to get one of these. Watch me. And I go back and I was driving mine. And I was just like,
this is all good.
Yeah. I was like, I can afford it. But I'm like, nah.
Yeah.
There's no need to keep up with the Joneses. You know
that's
what I mean? I
was like, you just I'm fine. Keep money, you know? Bro.
Exactly.
You know, and I think that's, you know, I'm on this main buzz of just like trying to, you know, just trying to accumulate money. You know, I've shot myself in the foot. You know, just the numerous amounts of time, you know, and, you know, grateful for the amount of support that's come through for this journey. And now I don't want to revisit that. Like, I want to utilize the money that's coming for the dream.
Lessons.
But now I want to, like, you know, accumulate, like, I've had to do that. I had to ask for help. I had to, you know, receive money from people, which is quite difficult to put yourself
in. For some
in.
People, it's really hard, but I've never, like, that guy, he was my first sugar daddy, put it that way.
Yeah.
Like, literally, like, there would be times when I was just struggling as a coming up, and then I'd just be like, yo, can you loan me like $5,000? Okay. And there's no, like, because sometimes people have loaned me money before, and it's just that, like, you feel this.
Yeah.
And then, I hate that feeling. And I try and pay it back straight away. But with him, within like 3 months, I'll just pay it back, and then boom, that's it.
Man.
Done. And it's just like grateful. And then even sometimes when it would be longer, then I'll give him back, you know, $6,000. Just like, thanks for believe, and he never asked for that. But I never find it hard to ask for help when I need that. And I think it's for men as well, because you find it's weak. Right. You know, like, that's the thing that they've put or instilled in us since we're kids. Like, you know, don't cry, right. If you're asking for handouts, you're weak. It's like, nah, sometimes you just have to know when, hey, I can't help myself right now. Can you help me? But yeah, you have to be willing to help yourself. And you, that's one of the reasons why I feel okay in supporting you, because I know you are trying to help yourself, but not just that, you're trying to help other people.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So for you, never feel bad for asking for help for anything.
Yeah, and I think that's an important...
It's a greater good. You're doing it for other people as well.
And I think, you know, it's just like for me now that they're, you know, now that the dream is sort of like becoming the reality, that's why I'm sort of like on this journey of like just trying to like normalize and learn about money and business, because, you know, I do want to pay it forward.
Yeah.
And I do, that's, you know, being on the receiving end of just so much generosity.
Yeah.
Like, the thing that I really have encouraged most by is, yet the money's coming in, there are people who are standing with me, but man, I want to be able to provide that for other people too. You know, I want to make other people's dreams come to reality, and I need to like get myself in check. So, you know, just getting into that space, and the thing that I like about you with not getting the Range Rover is the thing that people need to realize about money that I'm starting to learn myself is it's not about earning money, it's about keeping money. And it's about making money work for you.
Make that money grow.
Yeah.
Make that money, that money to work. Passive income.
You know, bro. And like,
Don't get me wrong. After this fight, I'm going to get me a sports car. Yeah. I read this. I was like, I want a McLaren. I went shopping like 2 months ago and I was looking. I was like, okay, Ferrari, McLaren. Because in my head, I've always had this. Like, even Diamond, Blood Diamond's one of my teammates. When he went to China first, I was using his beat up Honda. That was the only car I could use at the time. And it was a manual. And I remember whenever I drive it, anytime I shift gears, I do this.
Yeah.
Like, you know, that paddle shift?
Oh, yeah,
like,
yeah.
So I'd like...
Yeah.
And this became a habit. Like, but for me, it was me preparing my mind, like, one day, I'm going to be driving one of these things, and da, 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 da. And certain things, you get to this point, and it's like, it's weird. You get to this point, now, people want to give you things for free. People want to just, like... And even for me, I, like... When I was working at, you know, my old job, I'd be like, man, looking outside Foot Locker, like, whoa.
One of these days.
When I'm rich, I'm gonna get that. But then now you get to this point, it's like,
because you're actually a hobo. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, hey. Actual hobo life.
Like hobo life.
#hobo life. That's me. So like for me, I'd like literally like now you can afford it. You don't want it. Your priorities change. But if something's like that Lamborghini keeps staying in my head, I'm like, I'm gonna get that. Let me cop that one time. Just to see what it tastes like.
Yeah.
I just want to ride around in that for the summer. If I like it, I'll keep it. But I just, certain things, like, I like to flex. I like to enjoy my life. I like to enjoy the things that this fame, like I said, fuck fame. I love the perks of this fame. But, you know, like I said, the car is just like, if I get that Range, then it'll just be like, I don't know. I wouldn't be doing it for myself. I'd be doing it to try and flex on other people.
Right.
You know what I mean? But certain things I want to do for myself because I feel like it empowers me.
I think, bro, I want you to speak on that because I know you're on this journey of like, you know, trying to diminish this tall poppy syndrome. And I think it's really important, bro, because I think there's times where we need to flex to celebrate the hard work, you know, what has gone in to really celebrate this moment. But you shouldn't feel bad about that. So what are your views around this tall poppy syndrome that is just so heavy here in NZ?
Yeah. So yeah, with tall poppy syndrome, like in New Zealand, it's part of the culture in the low-key way. But then... I'm telling you, like, when I went back to Nigeria, I could see it as well. Like, I see the love and stuff like that, but then I'd see the, he had to leave here to go make his dreams come true. And it's like, did I ask to leave? There's so many different reasons economically as well why I had to leave. But the syndrome itself, I don't know. I could never, my brain doesn't work in a way where I can relate to someone with that kind of mentality. Like I shared the example earlier on with Ra, where it was like I was feeling some type of way because of his success that I started to pull away from him, and I was like, no, wait, why am I pulling away from my friend? His success takes nothing away from me. So I had to question myself and then fight that at myself rather than just accept it as what it is and then he's only doing it because he left for Australia. And I think that's one thing that a lot of people have to question themselves and ask themselves is like, why am I feeling that way? Because I mean, look, you don't have to like me. I like me. You don't have to like me. I like me plenty much. My dog loves me. My people love me. My parents love me. And I have enough for myself that, and also just respect for myself that I'll never ever like dim my shine to make someone else feel comfortable. I used to be a people pleaser. Hard, man. Oh, bruh. I was coming up, I used to just try, just like, just to belong, you know what I mean? But then it just occurred to me later on, like, in my late teenage years, like, I can't belong. I can never belong. I'm not meant to belong. I'm meant to stand out. So eventually, I started to just own my blackness.
Be the broken native.
Actual, the broken native. I just started to own my blackness. Because I, like, and that meaning, like, you know, it started off as a crew, but, like, broken native, like, for me, it just meant so much. There's so many different ways I can chop that up. But, like, I was trying to be part of a tribe as a native, but I could never ever fit into any tribe. So, but I'm a man that can fit into many tribes now, because I've related to so many people from so many different walks of life, you know. But back to what we're talking about, the tall poppy syndrome, it's just something that I think people have to question themselves. Like I said, just ask yourself, if you ever feel jealous or ever feel envious or ever feel even angry, even happy, you're like, why am I happy for this person, you know? And explore that, you know. Feel that, like, cultivate that, see the steps that it took for you to get there, or even reverse engineer it. And I like to do that just because it helps me understand me a little bit better, like, you know. And yeah, I just, it's something sad though, man. Like, I've seen it, like, someone, like, say the All Black, any All Black, like, when they talk on the mic after the game, oh yeah, you know, I want to give a big thanks to the big guy upstairs, you know, we had a good game. You know, the boys push hard. And I can just, like, repeat line for line what exactly going to say. I'm like, bro, you fucking just won the World Cup. Or you just won some big game or whatever. Like, I'm just using this. I don't know if this actually, like, happened. I'm just using an example. Yeah. But, like, just, I'm just trying to say, like, express how you really feel. But a lot of people never do because they're scared of what other people might think.
Yeah.
Be like, oh, look at that eat-ass cunt. Like, I've seen that and I've experienced that. And people have done it to my face. And I've heard people do it. Because it gets back to you. People, like, and then you see them in your face, like, oh, hey, oh, congrats, bro. Fucking me. The man, bro. Bro, oh, pick. Oh, bro. Oh, you the man, bro. Fuck, I love you, man. I love you. I'm like, yo, I just heard you talking shit about me the other week. Like, what?
Yeah.
It's just culture. I think it's just something that can be broken. And I don't even like using the word culture, because it shouldn't be culture. Nah. I think it's just a disease. It's a disease that just needs to be cut. And we can't relate to that because we're from a different cloth. Like, we want to see people succeed. Like,
right. And example, we celebrate other people's
Brad,
success.
Brad, my teammate, he's going to be fighting on UFC 243. I know for a fact there's some people that would be like, oh, yeah, sure, bro. Me, bro. But the...
Why isn't it me?
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. And it's like, don't worry, your time will come. But they just, they don't... And it's something that has to be learned, and I think, I don't know if there can be a class for it, or if just, I think it just has to be a change within the people itself, and just, it's like network of change, people teaching people, like, it could start this off, and someone else might hear this, and then realize, you know what, I was feeling some type of way about Becky, maybe, you know, and then question how they're feeling, and then eventually teach other people to teach other people, and it'd be a network of change, but it's something that can be stopped, and I just don't like it as culture. I think it's a poison, it's a cancer. Yeah, I'm sure you experienced that recently as well.
And I think definitely, like, I feel like you just feel the vibe around certain people.
Oh, yeah.
And they're not rocking
trust
with
this.
You.
Trust this. I never and used like, to, man.
Yeah.
But nah, trust it.
Like I do, I trust it and I just sort of avoid it. You know, especially I think it comes to a point of, like, if you know who you are, if you know in your tent, if you know the people around you, they do rock with you, they do love you, you can just push that aside, because as long as you sort of respond to it or react to it, you're allowing that to affect your state of being. Yep. So for me, it's just like noting it, acknowledging it, but just brushing it by.
Acknowledging
and it. And I think for me at the moment, it's sort of like, it's still hard to, like, fuck, when it's just me and my fiance in Ipania, like, I'm like, fuck, you know, just like, yes, you know, I just like experience all these emotions around the right people who will celebrate with me, you know, because you, like, for me, I don't like doing that when people would just, we just can't experience it fully. Do you know what I mean?
100%,
so I think that's where that is for me. But you're so right, bro. And I think for me, what I've noticed is there's so much Māori sort of businesses coming up. And bro, the more that I celebrate that, the more that I'm starting to find confidence to celebrate myself more.
Yeah.
Because that's sort of coming back. And what I'm feeling is that although Māori are rising, there's still Māori trying to pull each other down.
Yeah. And grab I think, it in a bucket.
Yeah, and I think we're still trying to like find our way through there. But I think talking about it, becoming aware of it is so important, bro. But we've been chopping it up for an hour and 20 minutes, bro.
Already.
But I think one of the last things that we will talk about, bro, is like, what goes into your camp, you know, and on fight day, like, what do you, like, I know you...
We can go on forever.
You know, but what's the typical sort of, like, diet, bro? Like, what diet, do you eat? What's where's your mentality at on, like, fight night, on fight day?
Fight day, okay. So, I'll break it down, like, say, example, for this camp. So, I got signed to the UFC last year, 2018, and that was in February. And before then, till April this year, that was, like, a span of 17, 18 months. You know, had six fights and then won the world title, you know, or the interim world title. And then I needed to take a break because, like I said, you can't be always on. Like, my body was just, I was just camp after camp after camp after camp after camp. It was like, yo, hey, my body just told me, my soul really told me, even my coaches could tell, like, okay, you need to take a break. Go chill. Just go. And I went to Nigeria. I went to Dubai, you know, went down to Gisborne, went back to Whanganui and just enjoying... just living, you know, life. And then this camp started, right? So came in the heaviest I've been in life, which is like, yeah, you guys don't know. And then, yeah, for me, during camp, I eat relatively clean. Like, say I have a burrito, maybe a burger. But, like, if I feel like pigging out, if I feel like one thing I got addicted to this camp, like I said, I have a thing with sugar. I had these, what was it? Salted caramel Haagen-Dazs ice creams, and I go through a tub in a night.
You're like visualizing,
bro. Oh, bro, straight, like, it's the exact size of it as well. Yeah. Like, I'm holding it right now. Like, I saw it, bro. That is salted caramel as well. That's the flavor that gets me all the time. My baby sister introduced me to that, and man, that thing, man, oh, wow, so many things, so many feels. But then I'll pig out on that, and then, like, I'll go back to, like, being clean relatively. Normally it's on the weekend where I normally, like, tend to, like, let loose a little bit, but I don't like to limit myself in a sense where it's like, because if, put it this way, if I'm just like, no, I can't have it, no, I can't have it, there's gonna be one day where I'll break, yeah, and then I'll go all the way in, and I'll just get some Tim Tams and then everything else. So it's just like, if I feel like just having something, and I don't even like to use the word cheat meal, if I have a treat, you know, like, just a treat meal, then yeah, I'll have something nice like that just to, like, satisfy the craving. And the older I get as well, the more I realize as well, one thing, oh, I realized in the New York camp, your food affects how you think.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't know that. That was November last year, but it took me a while to, like, reading Charlemagne's book and stuff like that, because I was diving so deep into mental health, because I had people around me who were suffering and whatnot, and I could see it in people, and they didn't even know it themselves.
Right.
You know what I mean? I could see people acting really, really erratic, really, like, manic, and I'm like, man, this person hasn't been diagnosed, but they definitely got something going on. And this is not a, like, you know, there's a stigma around it.
Yeah.
You know? So, I like, look, we have a physical health. I go to the gym, you know? We have spiritual health, you know? I like to be by myself in my living room at 3 a.m., shadow boxing or dancing. That gives me my spirit fuel. Mental health, I see a psychologist when I need to. You know, like, example, I've got a meeting tomorrow. Pretty sure, just to download some stuff and then get, you know, like, get a mirror put back in your face so you can look at yourself from a different point of view.
Right.
And people just, when you say mental and then health, they're like, no, you have to look after your mental health. So yeah, something I realized last year in November, that what you eat definitely affects what you think, because there was a point where I was just going so in, but then I was just feeling so ugh.
Right.
And then once I started to clean my diet up, I remember I felt so, I was like, man, I need more veggies in my life. I need more fruit in my life. I need more, like, proper, like, food, not just, like, say, oh, I'll have some chocolate. Or I'll just, because there was a point last year I let go of everything. Lucky I'm metabolism. If not, I'd be a fat ass. I would be fat.
Bro, because you fucking got a wreck, bro.
Yeah,
you know?
I try. But, like, yeah, I work. But, that helps me a lot. So I stay active. Like, every single day of the week, I have, like, a workout or something. And most days, on average, I'll train 3 times a day. On average, there's maybe Thursday where I train 4. I train 4. There was a point when I was doing 5 a day on Thursday, and there was, like, not too much. So we put one back. But,
And these sessions, are they, like, an hour long per workout, roughly?
Each one is different. Okay, so example, today's Thursday. I did 9 a.m. I did my lactic capacity with the boys. That was about an hour. Then after that, MMA, technique, you know, technical work, and that's like not light. It's light, but like, yeah, I'll say it's light training. But you're still moving around, you're still moving the body, still working the mind, learning techniques. And then normally I'd have strength, but I'm starting to cut weight now, so I pulled away from that. Normally I have strength, and then that's on Thursday. And after that, I have wrestling. So I wrestle. I did three today. So that's on the average day. And you have Saturdays where I spar, and then that's the only one for the day. And then Sunday, there's spider. That's just like
the kill-off.
That's the kill-off. Woo! That's the worst fight of your life. And then it's even when you're doing five rounds, sometimes you just have to go to that place, and then you get to the fifth round where it's just like, yeah. And then they like, it's work. Like, I would say, sweat more in training and bleed less in battle. We put that sweat in, man. We put that sweat in. And yeah, but when, like, now it's like maybe 3 weeks out, I start to like I appreciate the meal you made today, because it was perfect. It was delicious, perfect. And that's what I need right now, just clean food that goes down easy and doesn't like stay in there. And
right.
Then, you know, like no kind of like, you know, fettuccine or whatever that's going to like weigh
make you heavy, make you tired.
Like, yeah, that kind of stuff. So sure. Right now, 3 weeks out, I start to eat a little bit more like that, like clean. Like, example, today, this morning, I had... What did I have this morning? I had the berries, yogurt, granola. And then this afternoon I had bananas, three bananas, I told you, with the honey and the peanut butter.
Yeah.
And then dinner was that. And then, yeah, now I'm just going to, you know, maybe have, I might have a snack. I don't know.
Later on.
Yeah. So it depends. Like now I'm just trying to bring the weight down slowly. And then fight week, when it's like one, like the week before the fight week, I have like these guys help me out with, they pretty much have it sus, because I'm not like a nutrition guru, you know, like, so I have people who are smarter than me to help me get to that point. So they weigh me every morning, and then they prepare my meals according to my weight and also according to my schedule. Where am I going to be at? Da, 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 da. Then they bring my meals to me, and then I've never missed weight. So I always make weight. And then after that, then there's a night before the fight where it's just, you can taste it.
Eat.
You can just taste it, man. Or not, like, I still don't, like, eat too crazy, because it's just, like, I made that mistake when I was younger. Like, you literally just,
yeah,
get to the fight.
Just feel like shit, eh?
And you just, yeah, you don't want that.
Oh, at least you learn from mistakes, yeah, bros.
Bro, I only, well, sometimes three times I make mistakes, but I'll learn.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, I look forward to fighting, man. Like, that one thing right now, this fight, I'm looking forward to this fight for so many reasons. First of all, the Oceania rivalry, you know, the Aussie versus the Kiwi, you know, the Mozzie versus the All Black. And I just like that story. It's happened over time through rugby and through other things. But this is the real deal. This is fighting. At the end of the day, we all play sports, you know, but we're trying to find out who the baddest man is. You know, like,
yeah.
Everyone likes a scrap, you know. Got eye problem. Whoa. 1 ounce. Go on then, can't. Like, you know, like all that kind of stuff. I've seen it through high school growing up in Rotorua and Whanganui. But like, we're all trying to see like anything. You see any rugby, there's fights. League, there's fights. Basketball, football, there's always fights. So this is just the biggest fight in this region ever, you know. And to, like I said, last time I was in that same stadium, I was in the nosebleeds, you know, in the broken noses. And now, you know, I'm about to make
you're
nosebleeds.
In the cage.
Yeah. So it's like, it's a weird full circle thing, man. And I look forward to that fight because of many reasons. Like I said, he's a formidable opponent. He's a tough guy. He's strong. Like, he's a warrior. And I like that. I like going to people's land, slaying their best guy, and then leaving with a bunch of loot. Like, it's still that gladiator stuff. Like, even this camp, there was a point, maybe 3 weeks ago during sparring, like, we're getting ready, I was putting my wraps on. I remember just, like, having this moment of appreciation. Like, man, I'm going to miss this shit when it's gone. So appreciate it now. Like, really, really soak it up now. Because I'll be training forever. Don't get me wrong. I'll be doing martial arts forever. But, like, this, like, doing my rap, getting ready for sparring with my boys, and just that gladiator mentality, like, we're about to go to war. Like, this is all the prep that we're going to go to war. And I can't wait, man. Like, it's just, that fight's going to be, let's put it this way, it's not going to go to the finish.
But
yeah. I'm not even looking for the finish. I just know it's not going to go to the finish. It's just the way the fight plays out of my head through MMA maths. And when you look at the styles, you know, you look at, even one thing Eugene said, you know, I'm rambling on here, but like Eugene said in the interview, I didn't watch it, but I saw like a someone quoted it, and it was a lot of Israel's opponents never ever acknowledge him, his full set of skills. They always try and downplay his skills. I was like, true, they do. And he said, the minute someone fully gives him full acknowledgement of his skills is when I'm going to be really worried, you know, because no one, like everyone, oh, like
just
what
stand up.
Yeah. Like, yeah. It's, oh, that Israel, he's not as good as he thinks he is. That's what Robert said. He's not as good as he thinks he is. I'm like, all right, I'll show you I'm greater than I think I am. Yeah. But they don't know yet. Like every single one of them, they'll say the same thing. But when they're in front of me, like the last guy, the Mexican, you know, oh, I don't think he has any pop in his punches. Doesn't have any power in his punches. I'm like, all right, watch this. Boom, another one. Have some bread. More and more and more. And then they all have to, like, at the end of the day, they might not like me, but they will respect me. At the end of the day, they will respect me. And that's the athletes themselves, people in the UFC. But
do you go in and do you respect them as well? You know,
before that, like example, this guy, Robert, there's a respect in the sense where I know what he's good at doing. I know, you see him, he's a family man, he's a guy, I don't know what happens behind the scenes, but he seems like a stand-up guy, he seems like a nice guy, like he's got, you know, that energy about him. But I've also, I know in this game, it's not a nice game, you know, it might be a nice guy, but it's not a nice game, but also I know what it takes to get into that cage, so as much as you're, oh, hi everyone, I know there's something else beneath the surface when it's you and me, because we know we're going to have to fight, and he tries to play it like, oh, I don't care, I'm just going to go out there and fight, I don't care, and I'm like, you do care.
Yeah,
I care. This is the biggest fight in the fucking in the history of the UFC in my eyes. So I'm like, I care. You should care. If you don't, you're about to find out.
Yeah.
But yeah, even to the people who, like, sometimes, like I said, not everyone's gonna like you, but people like try and like downplay my skills as well. Like, oh, he's only the interim champ. He's not the real champ.
Yeah.
Robert is the interim champ. So Robert Whittaker beat, I think it was Yotamero. Oh, was it Yotamero? Yeah, he did, to get the interim belt while Michael Bisping was out. Then eventually Michael Bisping came back and fought GSP. Then GSP beat him and took the middleweight belt. So then there was going to be a clash between GSP and Robert Whittaker, like me and him right now.
Right.
But then GSP was like, nah, I'm going to retire. And then suddenly Robert's the champion. But I'm like, you still the interim champion. Who made you the champion? Someone died and made you champion? Or retired and made you champion? Yeah, so like someone retired and made him champion. And I'm like, well, if that's what you need to believe, like, cool. Because he's never actually defended the belt. He's never actually won the original belt. So I feel like this is the real fight for the real middleweight belt. And, man, the way, you know, the way things are playing out, even earlier on, he was acting so out of character, mate. And people were like, oh, he's so offended because he made a meme about me. I'm like, and I brought attention to the meme, but I was like, I'm not offended by the meme. I'm just saying, when was the last time this guy even talk shit about anyone? Like, he's acting out of character. I got these boys acting out of character, so that says a lot about them. That already shows their hand. And this is mental warfare has already begun from the first time I met him. I remember I met him, I was like, you smell nice, and he's like, oh, so do you. And I meant it, I was like, he smells really nice. But the game, we already knew what was gonna happen. So three more weeks, man. Like, I'm looking forward to the fight. The fight's already, it's one and done, but from now, making it to the fight, that's where the battle is, walking through that cage. Oh, I can't wait, man. And it's been beautiful, like, you've seen it, you know. That's the thing, like, sometimes I have to step back as well and just like, this is really happening. But like, yeah, I forget all the time, that's the thing. So I have to remind myself, you have to look back and just be like, oh shit, you're really doing this.
And just appreciating it, eh?
Yeah. But I love, like, watching your journey as well, man. Like, what you're doing is so, because in this game, I have to be real selfish with my time and with my energy a lot of the times. Even though I share it, I still have to be. But for what you're doing, it's so selfless. So I take a lot of inspirations from your posts and your videos and what you're doing, for not just for you, but for the community. Because I have to be selfish so that people can look at me and I can say what I have to say to push the culture forward. You know what I mean? Like Ali used to say, I only have all these things so people can look at me and then listen to what I have to say. Yeah. Not trying to put myself in that same light.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, like, I for what I want to do for the culture, but for me, watching people like you do it right now and be on the ground floor doing it, it gives me ideas and it gives me inspiration for what I want to do in the future. I respect that.
Respect you, brother. Yeah. And I think we sort of on our own journeys, but we bounce off one another. We're celebrating each other in that sense. And there's rising that mutual tides, respect, man, and love, bro. So honestly, even just doing something like this, it's, you know, 1 hour and 36 minutes. And, you know, just want to like thank you for your time, bro. It's appreciating just connecting again on this level. And, bro, like, you know,
we'll do it again. Definitely.
And we'll definitely do it again. Definitely, but I really appreciate, you know, you just jumping into the space, because this podcast is sort of like going beneath the layers. And you know, I just really hope that the listeners and the people who are watching this actually get to see Israel Adesanya outside of the Stylebender.
So you even say it properly, Adesanya.
Yeah. But cheer, my bro. I really do appreciate you, Izzy. People who are listening, the fight in 3 weeks, and we're definitely going to be tuning in.
243 Melbourne, Australia. I think some tickets still in sale.
The ultimate fighting world championship.
It's going to be crazy, man.
Let's go. Like,
I've got me, I've got Dan Hooker, my other teammate Brad Riddell, who just got signed. And like, I'm looking forward, like Dan said it in one of the videos, I'm looking forward to the corner. Like, it's going to be in the back, in the locker room, because we've got three fighters. We're going to have a lot of people from our gym in the back, and it's just going to be a party, man. I can't wait. It gives me chills thinking about it.
So cool, brother. Yeah. Awesome, my bro. Appreciate you, my brother. Thank you, sir. Love you heaps.
Love you, man.
Moriore te whanau. Let's go.